Thanks for joining us today. We are always encouraged to know that God is using this ministry to touch lives all across the world through what He's doing right here in Murphysboro, Illinois. Please take a moment and share what God is doing in your life by sending an email to info@cccmurphy.com. We trust that you will be blessed by today's message.
Debbie's father, I was sharing in the office this morning, Debbie's dad believed in me when I didn't believe in myself. I remember being a young man, probably around 19 or 20 years old, and him looking at me, and he looked at me, and he said, he used to call me Reverend Rick. Don't any of you call me that. And he looked at me, and he said, Reverend Rick, he said, one of these days, he said, you'll be flying all over the world preaching this gospel. I looked at him and I said, no, not me. I said, if I can't drive, I'm not going. I ate those words over and over and over and over again. But I was amazed at his ability to see something that I couldn't see. And aren't you glad that there are people that God sends in your life that can see that in you? Today at the end of this service, we're going to be having a baptism. So in light of that, because today is the first day of the year, I thought we would do this a little bit different. That's why we're doing this at the end of the service. If there are any of you here today that want to be baptized at the end of the service, we have baptismal robes, I think, for you in the back where you'll be able to change into those and be baptized at the conclusion of the service today. And I want to encourage you. Baptism, I remember being in a service one time and they got to talking in the class. I was there visiting as an evangelist to preach. And the class got to talking about, well, you don't have to be baptized to be saved and all this stuff, you know, going back and forth. And I thought, boy, that's such a slippery slope to get on. And they brought, you know, and all of a sudden they asked me, they said, well, what do you think? I said, well, while it's true that the only thing that can save a man is the blood of Jesus, I said, a man that would look me in the eye and tell me after Jesus died for him that he didn't want to be baptized with him, I'd really have to question whether or not he ever got saved to begin with. I just think that this question isn't about, am I baptized? This question is about, are you willing to follow Jesus? And Jesus thought baptism was important enough that he himself went to John and said, baptize me. John said, are you kidding me? He said, you want me to baptize you? He said, I've got need for you to baptize me. And Jesus said, suffer it to be so the scripture will be fulfilled. What was he saying? He's saying, I'm setting an example for all to follow. So there's something significant about baptism, that when we go down in the water, it symbolizes that we are burying the old man. And when we come up, we come up in a newness of life with Christ. Aren't you glad for that today? If you have your Bibles, I want you to go with me to Isaiah 43, verses 18 and 19. I want to preach for you for just a little while this morning. I know it's New Year's Day, and I know that we're a little thin this morning. I figure there was a lot of people out probably partying last night, bringing the new year in, all our saints. And but we're glad you're here. I want to leave a thought with you today. A new day, say this with me, a new day, a new year, a new life. Let me say it again. A new day, a new year, a new life. In Isaiah 43, 18, do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word because it's life to us. We ask you to have your way today, and we give you the praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen. When Debbie told me last night, she said, I want you to go. She said, Dad would want you to preach today. And so I felt like the best way that I could honor his memory is to share God's word with you and something that he'd stood for so many years of his life. And I thought about a new day. We started the first of this year in church. It's a new day. Everybody say a new day. Think about that gift from God. There's a saying that says, yesterday is history. Tomorrow is a mystery. Today is a gift. That's why we call it the present. And I always tell everybody, I said, so you ought to unwrap your present and live it to the fullest. A new day is a gift from God. How many of you have ever had a bad day? Wave your hand if you've ever had a bad day. Weren't you thankful when that day came to an end? And you said, hey, it's a new day. You were able to wake up and that day had passed and it was a new day. We talk about a new year. How many of you have ever had a year that you felt like came from the pit of hell? You know what I'm talking about? It's just like everything, you know, it's like everything unloaded that year. And I know we don't like to talk about, we're children of God, bless God. We've all had those moments in our life. There's nowhere in Scripture where God ever promised you that life was going to be easy. What he promised was, I'll be there for you. He said, I'll never leave you or forsake you, but I'll go with you to the ends of the earth. How many are glad that you've got a God that'll go with you? I've had some friends that would go with me so far. Matter of fact, I've had some friends that talked me into going, and then they backed out. And so sometimes what happens is we find ourselves in a place that we don't want to be and can't even figure out how we got there. And so the gift of a new year is a wonderful thing that we ought to cherish. Everybody say, a new year. 2017, I want to declare some things to you about 2017. In 2017, the church is going to find its authority again. In 2017, our voice is going to be heard. We're going to stand up like we've never stood up before. We're going to take back territory that the devil took from us. We're going to lay claim to our families. Even when they say they don't want anything to do with God, they don't know what's getting ready to hit them. The power of God is going to apprehend us and bring us in. And let me just share this with you, because if you got your mind made up, well, I ain't going to live for God, I ain't going to do that. Your arms are too short to box with God. Amen. I'm just telling you right now, if you think Muhammad Ali was a boxer, you ain't seen nothing until Jesus lays one on you. I remember being in places before and thinking, I'm done, I'm finished, and all of a sudden, God would touch me by his spirit. And I know some of you aren't going to understand this, but have you ever seen a knockout, a KO punch? Hold your hand up if you've ever seen a KO. You know, now we've got what boxing used to be the thing. Now it's what, UFC? Is that what it's called? You know, where you're able to bite the other guy's ear off and spit it. You know what I'm talking about? Just going after it and going after it. And I've seen some of those. Jonathan came to me one time. He said, Dad, watch this clip, this YouTube. And it was like the best knockouts of the, if I'd thought about it, I'd have brought that up. The best knockouts of the UFC. And you see these guys and all of a sudden, man, it's like they pow. And as soon as they got tapped, you just see them become jelly. You know, they're still standing on their feet. They're knocked out and they don't know it yet. And I mean, just wham, wham. And you say, what a fight, what a fight, what a fight. And I'm thinking, I've had God do that to me. You say, well, how's that? You need to ask my wife one time about the meeting we were in when all of a sudden I got a KO punch from God. It flipped me over. I did a backward flip. I can't do a backward flip when I'm conscious. I did a backward flip, and everybody in the church looked like that, and you know, and they were all, oh, and they knew that had to be God. I'm not, you know, these dancers go flipping across that stage, buddy. If I ever do that, you know that's God. But what I'm saying is this, is we treat God like he's just out in left field, just kind of monitoring our life and saying, well, I hope they get through that. God is center stage. And he wants to have control of our life. And we have to make up our mind that we're going to give it to him. Turn around, look at your neighbor and say, what are you waiting for? So let me talk to you about the scripture. It says, do not remember the former things. How many of you have ever met somebody that couldn't get over their past? You can't live in the shadow of your past. You say, but you don't know what I did. No, but God does. I had a guy come up to me one time, man, the Lord spoke to me to drive over this place. I drove, it was about 7 miles from where I lived. I drove over there, I got there and knocked on the door. When I knocked on the door, his mother came to the door and I said, is Earl here? And she said, no, he's not, he's working. And I was standing on her porch and I said, man, I said, I said, he's working. And she said, yes. And I looked at her and I said, man, I said, I really believe that God spoke to me and told me to come here and talk to Earl. And she said, well, I'm sorry, he's not. And all of a sudden she looked up and she said, well, here he comes right there. He came walking down the street and he came up on the porch and he came up and he said, I don't know. He said, I can't explain it. He said, I was 5 miles away. He was working for a farmer. He said, and something came over me, he said, and told me, get home. He said, I left the tractor in the middle of the field. I walked 5 miles to get to the house. I don't know why I'm here. I looked at him and I said, I know exactly why you're here. Amen. I took him aside and I started telling Earl about the power of God to save, about what Jesus did for us. And Earl started going back and forth. Well, God can't save me. God can't save me because, you know, you don't know everything I've done. I've done this and I've done that and I've done that. And I finally got about up to here with Earl. And I looked at Earl and I said, Earl, would you do me a favor? And he said, what's that? I said, would you quit telling my God what he can and what he can't do? God is more than able to save you. Do you think you've got a corner on the market of being lost? And man, he gave his heart to God and just surrendered right there. And I thought about how we, you know, but that's not the first time that's ever happened. I mean, how many of you, since you've been living for God, ever failed? Anybody living for God? I mean, unless you just got saved 5 minutes ago, there's a good chance. Let's try that one more time because a lot of you like to keep that down. I don't. How many of you have ever, since you've been living for God, how many of you have ever, let me say it this way, how many of you have ever slipped? See, we get more hands on slipped. Let me say it this way. How many of you, let's see if we can get our courage built up. How many of you have ever made a mistake? Oh. Yes, Pastor, I've made a mistake, yes. How many of you just outright sinned? Well, praise God, some of you are getting truthful in this house today. Those of you that didn't raise your hands need to repent before this service is over with. What are you saying? I'm saying no matter how you slice it, no matter how you look at it, you're not going to get through this life without failure. How can you say that? Because I know flesh. Look, if I could get through life without failing, he would have never had to go to Calvary. But because he went to Calvary, now my failure can no longer dictate to me. It cannot define me. It cannot stop me. But if I'm willing to say, God, forgive me, I've sinned, here I am, I need you. But when we act like we walk on water, it's when we get into trouble. So, you've got to be, he says, forget the former things. You can't live in the shadow of yesterday. Do you remember? That's what happened to Israel. They had come across, and you know, they were doing so great, man. The Red Sea had parted for them. The Jordan River had parted for them. They had subdued so many kings and kingdoms, and then all of a sudden they go in and they take out Jericho walls that are over 18 feet thick. They destroy that place. And the next time they have to face a group of people, and they're just a small group of people. And Joshua said, well, we don't need to send everybody. And they go down there and they lost the battle. Joshua's on his face. He's beside himself. God, what am I going to do when Israel, you know, can't stand before its enemy? I might as well. He started sounding like they used to sound. We'd have been better off just to not have come out here. We'd have been better off. Did you see what God's response was to him? He said, God looked at him and he said, get up! I'm not making that up. There's an exclamation mark after that in Scripture. He said, get up off your face. What's he saying? Can I put it in plain English for you? This is what God told Joshua. Quit wallowing in yesterday and get up off your face and deal with the problem and move on to victory. Amen. How many of you ready to move on to victory? And just turn around. You know when you say that loud? It's when your husband overslept and he's late for work. And you go in, get up! Gotta go make me some money. There's gonna be a sale this week, the end of the holiday season. Go, get up! See, we lose so much by just laying around and letting the devil work us over. You've got to learn how to get up. Everybody say, get up. So now here's the other thing, but because it says, that scripture said, do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Everybody say the things of old. Now let me talk to you about the flip side of this, because I've been around those folks that always say, I'll tell you what, wish we could have a move of God like we used to have. Said, oh man, if we could just, you know, I remember how it used to be. I remember how, you know, we used to really have revival. We used to really, I don't mean to be short, but let me share this with you. If you're not having revival, it's because, and you used to have revival, and you're not having revival now, it's because you decided that people are bigger than your relationship with God. How can you let any circumstance or any situation stop you from having revival? They beat him, they whipped him, and he stood up before Pilate, and Pilate said, don't you know that I've got power over you? And Jesus said, you've got no power over me at all. I'm going to lay down my life, and I'm going to pick it back up. We need to make up our mind. It's a new day, it's a new year, and it's a new life. And I'm not going to let any situation or circumstance stop me now. They used to say, I did revival for 20 plus years. They don't call you to come hold a revival if you're going to come into the church and say, well, folks, I need y'all to pray for me because I'm really struggling. I hope y'all get something out of this message. I hadn't really got nothing yet. Revival comes from within you. Revival is not an outside source. It's determined by the relationship that you have with Christ. And if you've got that relationship with Christ, now look, I preached in some churches that were dead. Turn around, look at your neighbor and say, he said dead. I'm talking about dead, dried up, plucked up by the roots. You know, I'm talking about like your garden looks like about October. Dead. And I'll never forget, and I could call a place, I won't do it. It's just south of Vienna. And I remember, I was down there and I was preaching. Everybody was looking at me a lot like you're looking at me right now. I was in that place and I was preaching and folks were... And I could tell they were all thrilled to be there. And in my mind, I've said, I'm going to shut this down and get out of here. And God is my witness while I'm preaching. Now, how many of you know that God can have a conversation with you while you're doing something? Amen. Now, if any of you women are saying that's not possible, you know better. Because you can have a conversation and be thinking about five different things at the same time. You know what I'm talking about? You have a highway, a super highway in your mind. It just, guys are usually one track. What'd you say? That's why when you're talking to them and they're watching the television, you don't get an answer. Huh? So I'm praying. Well, actually, I'm preaching. And I'm thinking in my mind, I need to shut this down. And God spoke to me and said, quit looking at their faces and preach what I'm giving you. And man, I just kept going at it. Debbie told me later, she said, I was thinking, how in the world is he staying that excited in here? How is he continue to preach like that? And I kept going, just trusting God. And I tell you, at the end of that service, I thought, well, God, I did what you asked me to do. But this has gone over like a lead balloon. And I got up to give the altar call. And in my mind, I thought, boy, this has died, man. And I gave the altar call. And I thought, I'm just going to give this altar call, get out of here. I wasn't expecting nothing. Boy, there's a man of faith. How many of you have ever done something and then not expected anything? You know, here's what you've got to understand. Faith isn't about what you see. It's about what you know. That's why you can reach out and get a hold of it. Faith, the substance, it's something I get a hold of things hoped for, evidence of things not seen. It's not that I've already seen it. It's that I know that God can do it. And so I reach out and grab it. And I got to that altar call. And when I gave that altar call, I was thinking, man, this is going to be a short altar call. We're going to be out of here. I gave that altar call. That guy, there's a guy in the back that looked like he was about half asleep during the whole message, jumped up out of his pew, came running to the front of that church, and that whole place broke out in revival. Everybody started jumping up and shouting because they knew his life. Do you understand that God can do whatever he wants to do because he's God? It's not according to the environment that's around you. God's bigger than your environment. Amen. It's not according to the people that are for you or that are against you. God's bigger than all those people. And so what you've got to do, but you're never going to embrace the future if you keep looking to the past. You're never going to experience revival now if you think your best days are behind you. You got to learn how to get up, shake it off, and say, God, I give you praise. This is the day the Lord's made. I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it. It's a new day. It's a new year. It's a new life. You've got to change your way of thinking. How many of you have had some stinking thinking? Let me tell you what a preacher told me. He said, if you've got stinking thinking, you need a checkup from the neck up. Amen. So scripture said, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed how? By the renewing of your neighbor's mind. Well, if they'd act better, if my spouse would treat me better, if they'd understand how important I am. No, the renewing of your mind. Say it, the renewing of No, not my mind. There, thank you. The renewing of my mind. Put your hand on your head and say, God, straighten it up out there. I think I said that wrong. Straighten it out up there. There we go. What we need, we've got to start thinking differently according to what he said about us and not what we've said or think about ourselves. Everybody say, behold, I do a new thing. He said, shall it not spring forth? He didn't say, shall it not drag out? He said, shall it not spring forth? Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. We had some problem with some property recently where my daughter lives. There is a, I went up to the county and, you know, we had the, what's that called, schematic or whatever it is, the layout of that land. And they said, well, there's a problem here. So there's a road that runs right through her property. I said, no, there's not. Yes, there's a road. There's a road runs right through the property. I said, look, there's not a road. And there's a road. I said, there is a field that runs right through her property. I said, it might say there's a road on your map, but there's no sign of a road there. I said, I've been there for the last over 20 years. There's never been a road there. I said, there's not a road. Well, there could be. I said, I got good news for you. If a road, if they decide to build a road through that land, it's going to deliver her at her front door. It's going to, I said, it's not going through her house. It's not going through her, it's going to go right through. I said, that's public access. I said, if they build a paved road, she's going to get to go down that road right to her house. We're arguing about things that don't even exist. Oh, but it could happen. Well, praise God. If it happens, he'll work it out. But quit chasing shadows. Old things pass away. All things become new. Everybody say, a new day. You got to quit thinking the way you used to think. You've got, how many of you have ever had any problems with your thinking? Let me make this easier for you. How many of you sitting next to someone that's had problem with, no, I'm kidding. Just, you know, isn't it amazing? We can always pick out when others are having problems with it, but we don't recognize it ourselves. Look, here's the thing. You have to understand that we're the way that we're created from earth. So there's some earthly stuff in us. Everybody say, there's some junk in me. I'm not gonna say that. So here's what I'm saying is this, that when God breathed into me, he overpowered the tangible and he put something supernatural in me so that now I am no longer a slave to the natural part of me, but I have become victorious through that supernatural part of me. So what he breathed, here's how the scripture said it. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Everybody say, he's greater. But we've got to let him be greater in us. So take a look at this. In Haggai, when we talk about living in yesterday, everybody say, living in the former glory. Now this, here's where we have to really be careful about this, because as we get older, the older we get, the better yesterday looks. Why? Let me tell you why. It's because the older we get, the more aches and pains we feel. So we start thinking about a day when there were no aches and pains. And we automatically gravitate to that. But can I share with you that Moses lived to be 120 years old. And it said that his natural forces had not abated him, neither had his eyes grown dim. Somebody told me, well, you just keep believing that. I said, I'm going to. What other hope do I have? Amen. I'm not going to let go of today and begin to try and go to yesterday. I've got to move forward from here. Everybody say, move forward from here. Look at the book of Haggai. In the book of Haggai, chapter 2 and verse 3, it says, who is left among you who saw this temple in its former glory? How do you see it now? In comparison with it, is this not in your eyes as nothing? Here's what God's saying. He's saying, look, I know those that saw the former temple are looking now and they're saying, well, that's nothing, man. I mean, the way it used to be, the way, it, you know, this temple used to really be something special. Listen to what God says. God makes a statement. He says, the silver is mine and the gold is mine, says the Lord of hosts. The glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former. And in this place, I will give peace, says the Lord of hosts. If you're not careful, you take your life and you make it that temple. You start looking at your life and you were saying, my best days were behind me. And God's saying, your best days are not behind you. I've got something in store for you. I'm going to do a new thing in you, and it's going to be better than the past. Turn around and look at your neighbor and say, better. Man, I can tell you all stayed up late last night. Say it one more time, better. So here's what we've got to do. We can't start trying to hold on to, you know, I came across a picture of myself when I was younger. Man, I was good looking. Who said that? Stand up. Two or three agree together. Praise God. No, just... What I'm saying is this, is I saw that picture, and for a moment, I found myself wishing I were back there. But man, I did some stupid stuff back there. You know, what's amazing is when we start thinking about the past, we think about everything that was good about it and everything that was wonderful about it, and we forget all the bad stuff. Can I ask a question? Have you ever been through a season of life where everything was perfect? No. Because no matter what season you're in, you're going to have challenges. Now here's the danger. If you're not careful, you won't see the glory of this season because you're too busy staring at yesterday. Amen. You have to understand that God's got something for you here now. Everybody say, right here, right now. Doesn't matter how old you are. Noah was 600 years old when he built the ark, right? 600 years old. But he lived 350 years after the ark. What did Noah do after he built the ark? He got drunk. Hang out here with me just a second. Don't anybody walk out now. I can't believe he said Noah got drunk. Noah got drunk. Do you know why Noah got drunk? It's because Noah started feeling like nobody needs an ark anymore. Noah had spent all those years, 120 years of his life, dedicated to building that ark. He got up thinking ark. He went to bed thinking ark. He spent all of his days and nights preparing that ark, and that ark did the job. It saved his family. But now on the flip, on the backside of the flood, he's beginning to look at what he accomplished, and now he's beginning to feel like nobody needs my ark anymore. Nobody cares about my ark anymore. And he begins to drink the wine of discontent, and he gets drunk in it. Hear me. We still need Noah, because what Noah tells us after the ark is that there's a God that can see you through the flood. We still need your story. We still need your song. We still need your testimony. Don't you throw it in and say, my best days are behind me. Your best days are still to come. God's got something great in store for you. I believe with all my heart that there's been a shift that's taken place. I believe that what we're going to see, and especially in this next year, is that there's going to be a thrust that the church experiences moving forward. We're going to gain ground. Folks that used to look at us and write us off are going to be trying to set up appointments with us and find out what we've got to say, because they're looking for answers. Don't give up on your dream. Don't throw away your vision. Let God reignite that fire in your heart. He promised that the glory of the latter would be greater than the glory of the former. Isn't that what Paul teaches? Paul said that we're being changed from glory to glory. I can't live. My relationship with God needs to be growing. No matter where I'm at right now. Man, even if I've got faith that can move mountains, my faith, my relationship with God needs to be growing. Even if I can do all miracles. Well, if you could do that, you wouldn't need to grow. That's not what the writer of Hebrews said. The writer of Hebrews said, if you've achieved all those things, but you haven't grown into a place of loving one another, then it means absolutely nothing. Turn around, look at your neighbor and say, I started to say, have you say, I sure do love you, but I was a little concerned who you might be sitting next to. So just say it this way. You're my brother. Now don't say that if it's a sister, okay? Just look at him and say, God has knit us together. We are family. And I love my family. Amen. Come on, give him a hand clap of praise. I want to end with this today. It's in Galatians 6, verses 14 to 16. This is in the New Living Translation. Paul's speaking. Listen to what he says. As for me, may I never boast about anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because of that cross, my interest in this world has been crucified. What's he saying? He's saying, since I met Jesus, there's nothing this world has to offer me that I want. And the world's interest in me has also died. What's he saying? My old friends don't like me. They don't like the new me. They don't like the fact that I quit carousing with them. They don't like the fact that I quit running around. They don't understand me when I say I'm drinking new wine. They don't understand it when I don't want to do what I used to do. They think it's because I got religious and I can't do it. No, it's not because I can't do it. It's because I don't want to do it anymore. Something inside of me has changed. I'm not the same person that I used to be. He said, it doesn't matter whether we've been circumcised or not, What's he saying? He's saying, look, all this stuff that the religious world's trying to put on you doesn't matter. Doesn't matter what side you part your hair on. Doesn't matter if you got open-toed shoes. Doesn't matter if you wear a suit and a tie or you wear Levi's. Well, then, why do you do it? Let me tell you why I do this. It's because when I stand behind this pulpit, I feel like I'm representing someone that deserves all the honor. Amen. I'm not saying that's right or wrong. I'm just telling you why I do it. President Reagan wouldn't step in the Oval Office without a jacket on. I just feel like every Sunday morning that I become an ambassador. Well, it's every day, but when I step behind this desk, I feel like, for me, I want to give my very best. It would have been easy for me to have stayed at home. I lost my second father today. My dad died when I was 15. I met Brother Russell when I was 18. He didn't have son-in-laws. He just had sons. I had a young man call me early this morning. And he said, I heard about Brother Russell. He said, do you think that I could say something at the funeral? And I said, I'll talk to the family. I said, but if you're not allowed to, it's not because they don't love you. It's because there'll be so many people that have so many things to say that there's no way that they can let everybody say it. You know what that young man was saying? That man made a change in my life. The way he lived his life, as John said earlier, influenced me. And it influenced me to live my life differently. When's the last time you've ever heard about a king leaving his throne to become a pauper and die on a cross? Did he have to? No. He didn't have to. He did it because he loved us. I wonder how hard it would be for us to grasp and get our minds around that kind of love. Because if you could ever grasp it, you'd quit living for yourself. You'd quit wanting to have your way, and you'd start saying, God, what do you want? Throughout my life, there have been times that I've looked at myself in the mirror and I've judged me. And I said, God, I know that's not pleasing to you. I don't want to be that way. That's not who you made me to be. Change me, God. I wasn't asking God to change somebody else so they could put up with me. I wasn't asking God to wink at what I was doing wrong. I was asking him to give me the power to overcome it. A new day, a new year, a new life. Finally, Paul says, what counts? He says, doesn't matter whether we've been circumcised or not. What counts is whether we've been transformed into a new creation. That's what counts, is are you different? Nobody had to tell me I was saved. I knew I was. how many of you remember Amway? Remember Amway? I used to sell Amway. I don't think any preacher could be a preacher if he hasn't sold Amway. I just, think that's part of what you're supposed to do, you know, read your Bible and sell Amway. I was selling Amway at the time. I'd gotten saved, and a guy I used to run around with, and he's gone on to be with the Lord now, so you can't call and find out about me. But I went to him, and I had that LOC. You remember that LOC? And I was selling him some of that stuff, and he looked at me, and he said, Rick, he said, you're different. I said, Troy, let me tell you about this difference. And I started talking to him about Jesus, and I saw it, man. He's getting under conviction. I could see it on his face. And all of a sudden, he goes, oh, that's all right, that's all right. He said, you know, you came to sell me this LOC. I said, forget about this junk. I said, I got something you really need. What matters is that you've been transformed, that you've been changed. You know what's wonderful? I've been with guys that have committed murder. I'd have never known it if they hadn't told me. Because God had gotten a hold of their life and they were transformed. The power of a new day. The power of a new year. The power of a new life. He says, may God's peace be upon all who live by this principle. I love this part. They are the new people of God. Would you stand with me? How many of you in here today would like to be new? Just new. Hold your hand up just a second. This is not a trick question. I'm not going to drag you out of your pew. Okay. Now, let me take this by stages, because here's what I want to ask. How many of you in here are saved already? Just hold your hand up if you're saved and you know you're saved, okay? Now, here's what I want to ask you. Those of you that are saved, is there something that you would like to see God do in you new and fresh? If there is, just hold that hand up. That's good. That's good. Why is that good? Because Paul says we're changed from glory to glory. When we get to the point that we just get satisfied where we're at, something's wrong. There needs to be a hunger in our heart that keeps drawing us to Him, that keeps saying, I want more of you and less of me. So it's a new day. You can have that today. Make up your mind, it's a new year. This is a year that I give it all to God, and God does something brand new in me. Now, if you're in here, and then you're going to find it's a new life, you're not even going to be the same individual anymore. Now, if you're in here, and you've given your heart to God, but you haven't been baptized yet, I want to give you an opportunity today. Say, well, Pastor, I'm going to get on the list. You don't have to wait. You can. I'm going to give you permission to leave the building right now. Where's Janet at? Janet's in the back. She's in the back. Matter of fact, I'll let you. You can come straight up through here and cut back there and walk back there and meet Janet. Janet's going to get you ready to be baptized. You can start out a new day, a new year, and a new life right now. And then your little... there we go. I got power back. I thought maybe I was getting bored in there for a second. If you're ready to do that, and you say, well, I'm afraid to go by myself, take someone with you and go on back right now. We're going to let you do that right now. If you've never been baptized, or you've been baptized and you feel like, look, man, I've messed up so bad, I feel like I need to repeat my first works. I'm not saying you've got to. I'm just saying if that's what you feel, then respond to that and do that right now. They're getting ready to sing in a second. I'm going to go back and change. And I'm going to meet some people in the baptistry. I hope you're one of them. I hope that you make up your mind right here. Not next week, not next month, not tomorrow, but right here and right now. I'm tired of the old me. Do you ever get sick of yourself? I mean, I'm tired of the old me. And I'm ready for a new me, the new people of God. I've got good news for you today. If that's what you want, God's already wrapping his arms around you and pulling you to himself and saying, you are my child. You belong to me, and I'm ready to give you that new day. As you stretch your hands to heaven, I want you to pray this prayer with me. If you're in here and you don't know God, it's not difficult to know him. Don't make it complicated. Don't jump through hoops and try and, you know, oh, I've got to exercise all these principles. All you need to do is say, Lord, forgive me. Would you say that with me? God, I repent of my sins. I ask you into my heart. I accept you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name. Give him a hand clap of praise, would you? Now, you may be saying, that's too easy. It couldn't be that easy. It wasn't. It cost him his life. 7-inch spikes ripped through his hands and his feet. A Roman whip tore open his back. He did the hard part so we could come to him. Amen. Give him one more hand clap of praise. I hope to see you there. Worship with them. I'll see you in just a minute. Of Christ, give him a big hand clap. And we're also going to be baptizing Elizabeth White Cotton. How about a big hand for her?
You are good.
electrocuted, know that I've had a good life. Hey, what an exciting time on the first day of a brand new year to say, Lord, I'm coming home to you. Amen. God bless you. You and keep you. May he smile on you. May you always find yourself the head and not the tail. Be blessed going in and coming out. And may you always remember there's no one like our God. God bless you. Everybody freeze in your tracks. We've got two more to baptize. And Jennifer Martin, but Mary's coming now. Take you right through the window. Just come on. God bless you. We love you all. Happy New Year.